If you would, look in your Bibles at Luke chapter 15. I'm only going to read about four verses. I've got one thing in particular I want to preach today. It might give it away when you get there. Luke chapter 15, and I want to begin reading in verse 17. This is the part of the parable known as the prodigal son. Verse 17 says, "And when he came to himself, he said, 'How many hired servants of my father's have bread enough and to spare, and I perish with hunger? I will arise and go to my father, and will say unto him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and before thee, and am no more worthy to be called thy son. Make me as one of thy hired servants.' And he arose and came to his father. But when he was a great way off, his father saw him and had compassion, and ran and fell on his neck and kissed him." I'm just going to stop right there. We're going to do some more, but I just wanted to read a little bit for time's sake. What I want to preach today is the prodigal son when he came to himself. Now, as I said, Walter is correct. When you said that, Walter, it hit on me some while back. This is one parable. This is one parable. There's a lost sheep, there's a lost coin, and a lost son. But it says this: Christ spoke to them this parable. Not plural, singular. It is one parable. Luke tells us that this is one parable. And before the lost son, we have the lost sheep and the lost coin. Which I like those two. I do, dearly. Both of those illustrations, the lost sheep and the lost coin, show us clearly the work of finding and bringing is not the work of the thing that is lost. Okay? A sheep is a dumb animal. Now, I know we're all sheep, but the way we're sheep is we've gone astray. You know, everyone's turned to his own way. And a coin is an inanimate object. It can't find itself. It's impossible. And that's what those first two parts show. The finding and the bringing are up to the ones to whom that object belongs. But we come to the son, and we get a little bit more involved, because we're actually, he's using an illustration of a human being. Someone is lost. And here, in this last part, we have man. And we see there is something that happens in the lost man, the lost son, which brings about a change in the lost son. There's a build-up, a progression to this last part of the parable. The work and the finding and the work of the bringing results in a change of that which was lost. And that change in that which was lost comes from the finding and the bringing, which is still up to the person to whom that son belongs. You can't forget the first two parts of the parable when you get to the third part. It's still not up to us. Because that changing, that finding, that bringing does make a change. And it results in coming to the Father. That statement, when he came to himself, or if you want to put the "and" in front of it, "and when he came to himself." Six words. And those are six of my favorite words in this scripture. I have read this, and I have read it and loved it for as long as I can remember. And I've heard people preach the prodigal son for 30 years and liked it. But this is the part that arrests me, that catches me, Walter, right here. This one little statement. This, is, for me, is the key to this whole prodigal son part of the parable. It's the cornerstone from which everything else comes right down the way it's supposed to. And the reason this means so much to me is because it is personal, and I can verify it's real. This is what happens inside every child of God. I know exactly what happened here to the lost son because it actually happened to me. I came to myself. I know this by experience, and this is an illustration of a real experience. This part of a parable sets forth a real truth in the life, I believe, in every single believer. Now, what I usually compare this with is found in Luke 8:35. I'm going to just look back there just a couple of few chapters. This is the account of the reality of what they call the Gadarene demoniac. Okay? This is a fellow that had legions. Christ asked him, "What's your name?" And the demons, the unclean spirits, said, "We are legion, for we are many." And they were cast out. They were cast out by Christ. They went into a herd of swine, and then the swine went and killed themselves. I'm not going to comment on how pigs are smarter than people, but somehow you kind of get that impression. Verse 35, though, this is after it's all over, okay? They've been cast out. Then they went out to see what was done and came to Jesus and found the man out of whom the devils were departed sitting at the feet of Jesus, clothed and in his right mind. And they were afraid. That's just an astonishing thing to me. The true power of God, the true power of Christ, frightens unbelievers. It really does. But the point here, he's in his right mind. He was not before. This guy was given lip to the Lord of glory. And Christ said, "Come out." And they came out. And there he is. Where? Sitting with Jesus. How do you know you're in your right mind? You sit at the feet of Christ. You sit at the feet of Christ. You listen to the Lord of glory, the Son of only begotten, well-beloved, the Son, hear ye him. And when this, back in Luke 15, this prodigal son, it says, when he came to himself, all of a sudden, the prodigal son is in his right mind. He wasn't before. This little phrase so often passed over in the parable of the prodigal son is my favorite because it states so clearly and utterly that now this son, this lost son, is now in his right mind. When he came to himself. And when you come to yourself, things have changed. And you have changed. Now, there is no mention here of what brought on this change, other than what we have of the lost sheep and the lost coin. Okay? That the owner of the sheep and the owner of the coin, they were the ones that were finding and bringing in this object. But it doesn't say anything about how. But I can tell you this, with full confidence of the scripture to back me up, that just like that Gadarene demoniac, it took a miracle of grace for that prodigal son, that lost son, to come to himself. Because coming to oneself, coming to yourself, coming to your right mind is not a natural act. It's not. Wasting your substance on riotous living, that's a natural act. Taking your father's money and running away from home, that's a natural act. That's the act of a natural man. Spending all is something we have to fight against. Why? Because it's a natural act. Joining yourself to a citizen of a far country, that's a natural act. Working away for another for no gain to yourself is a natural act. It shouldn't be, but it is. But when he came to himself, that ain't natural. It ain't. It's not natural. Why can I say that? Well, it is few that be that come to themselves. Not many are called. But this is a thing that happens to everyone who is being brought in to the adoption of sons. It's a narrow way. It's a straight gate, and few there be that find it. It's a broad way, and many, many, many are on that way to their destruction. Few there be that find that narrow way. I believe I am one of them. I believe this happened to me. My manner, mode, my thoughts changed one day. And I didn't cause it, Walter. I didn't cause it. I noticed it. I wondered what was wrong with me. I didn't know I was in my right mind. But if your thoughts haven't changed toward Christ, something is missing. If you haven't had a time when you came to yourself and you said, I will arise and go to my Father, something's wrong, because everything else comes from that. The lost son does come to Christ. The lost son does come to the Father by the Spirit of God himself. And if you haven't come to the realization that there is no hope outside of God, you don't know the Father, the Son, or the Spirit. This is a reality. I know it's a parable or a piece of a parable, but what Christ spoke here was exactly the truth. And that lost son knew exactly to whom to go. He knows to whom he is coming. Like I said, it doesn't say how, but I know how. I'll tell you here in a minute. Because here's the question. Do you recognize yourself in this statement when he came to himself? I recognize myself. That's why this scripture means so much to me. That's why I love this parable. Because when he came to himself is where there was a change in this son. He was a son before it happened. And he was a son after it happened. That's the reality. That's the reality. That's the parable. He was a son when he was lost. He didn't know he was lost. He thought he was having a good time and fine and pleased with and punched with himself. But there comes a day. And hopefully it won't take losing all you had. Hopefully it won't take having to work slopping hogs for someone when you'd rather eat what the hogs are eating. You're that hungry. And for most of us, it didn't. I can imagine the shock value. Jesus Christ here was speaking to Jews. And he told them this boy was out there slopping hogs. Hogs are unclean animals. You don't even hang around them, much less feed them so other people can eat them. But when he came to himself, everything changed for this son. Everything had changed. And after this, after you come to yourself, I'll tell you this, all kinds of good things follow. We come, we are met, we are received with joy. Why? Because after you come to your right mind, you say, I will arise and go to my Father. You will come. You will come to Him. You will come. And why? Because He will see to it. If you're in your right mind, you'll go to Christ. If you're in your right mind, you will come to the Father. It is all because of Christ Jesus. We are the sons and daughters of God. Our sonship, our adoption as sons, is because of the person and work of His only begotten Son. In Him, by Him, and through Him, the Son, we are not only in the family, we are brought into sonship. By His life, His death, His resurrection, His regeneration, His faith. It's all the work of Christ. Hence, therefore, sonship, being founded on resurrection, stands connected with perfect justification, perfect righteousness, perfect freedom from everything which could in any wise be against us. God could not have us in His presence with sin upon us. He could not suffer a single speck or stain of sin upon His sons and daughters. It's not going to happen. Now, when that son approached, the father saw him afar off. And the father went to him and fell on him. He recognized him, even though he was still in the rags he was wearing from a far country. Coming straight from the pigsty, I'm sure he was a very pretty picture. But the father knew that son at a distance. And he met him. And he fell upon his neck. And he hugged him. He kissed him. While he was still in the rags. You know what that is? That's grace. That's mercy. What is that? Compassion. That's what it says here. The father, though, would not have this son at his table still in those rags. The father could not have the prodigal at his table with the rags of a far country upon him. He could go forth to meet him in those rags, and he did. He could fall upon his neck and kiss him in those rags. It was worthy and beautifully characteristic of his grace to do so. That's the way C.H. McIntosh put it. I like that. Then he said, but to seat him at his table with rags would never do. Never do. The grace that brought the father out to the prodigal reigns through the righteousness which brought the prodigal into the Father. The Son's righteousness, Christ's righteousness. It would not have been grace had the Father waited for the Son to deck himself. Make a little money, buy you some clothes. No. Deck himself in robes of his own providing, and it would not have been righteous to bring him in his rags. But both grace and righteousness shone forth in all their respective brightness and beauty when the father went out, fell upon the prodigal's neck, but yet did not give him a seat at the table until he was clad and decked in an appropriate robe. An appropriate manner to which suited that elevated and happy position. You're going to eat at his table as a son. And you're going to eat at a table his table as a son clothed in the best robe, with a ring on your finger and shoes on your feet. All this comes from when he came to himself. That's where it comes from. The prodigal didn't have a robe, much less a good one. He didn't bring one with him. He didn't have one to bring. The father gave him not just a robe. He gave him the best robe. The best robe. And then the father said, bring hither and don't just kill any calf. Kill the fatted calf. This is a calf that was preparing for a feast. That's what it's there for. It was a fatted calf. It was already fat. This specially prepared calf for a special feast and special food for his son that was lost, that was dead, and is now alive. When you eat at the Father's table, the Father will make sure everything is exactly right. No matter whether it's the food or what you're wearing, the Father provides for his son.
Amen.
This is the Father's table. There's rejoicing and communion at the Father's table. They feed together. They feast together. They rejoice together. The prodigal didn't bring anything to this feast except his appetite. That's it. Father provided all of it. Now, when you take that verse about lifting that beggar off the dunghill to sit with kings and princes, guess what? You ain't going to look like no beggar. You're going to be wearing the best robe. You're going to have shoes on your feet and a ring on your finger. You're going to be clean, washed, as white as snow. And you're going to sit down with princes and kings. Just as this prodigal sat down. This son who was lost, but now is found, that was dead, is now alive. He's sitting at his father's table, clothed in his right mind, still. Because you know, once you come to yourself, you ain't never going to leave yourself. Once you're in your right mind, you're never going to be in your wrong mind again. Derangement is over. Well, that's one of the things he used in this, and it's true. One of the commentaries I looked at, this is when it says, you know, when it talked about when he came to himself, that's what we say about deranged people. Or drunks that are crazy. People in a rage full of, you know, anger management issues, as we call it nowadays. Oh God! And they come to themselves and they say, oh, wow, I'm sorry, I didn't mean to do that. Well, yeah, you kind of did. I understand the meaning, you know, because I've done things that, you know, I really shouldn't have done that, but you don't want to say that. But when you come to yourself, you will never not be yourself. And when you're seated at the Father's table, you are going to be fed the fatted calf. Wearing the best robe and a ring on your finger. The Father provides all the sustenance for his household. The elevation of the found son is shown here. This was not a feast that the found son had ever had before. That's the complaint of the elder son. Mason, I'm going to get to that. The Father provides all of the sustenance. He never had this before. What we're told here, the fatted calf had never been slain for this son before, or the elder son. Either one. Because that's one of the complaints of the elder son. You're doing this for him, you never let me or my friends have any fun. Never mind, I'll give it to that. But he does it now. The father had the fatted calf slain and cooked and prepared for this feast. And why was it done? Why was the prodigal son given this feast, this best robe, and this ring on his finger? There's only one reason given. The Father said so. That's all it takes. That's all it takes. If the Father says it's so, it's so. If the Father says do it, it's done. That's all the reason we have here, and that's all the reason we need. Because that's all the reason there ever really is. The reunifying, this reunifying of the lost Son and the Father gives the Son more than he ever had before. I like that statement. In Ephesians, God is reuniting all things together in Christ. This was my Son that was lost, and now he's found. This is my Son who was dead, and now he's alive. The Father will have the prodigal feeding upon the fatted calf in fellowship with himself. He will not assign him lower place than to set at his own table, nor any other portion than that on which he feeds himself. It's his table. And believers sit and eat at the table of the Lord, rejoicing. There's dancing and there's music. There's rejoicing at one sinner that comes in. There's rejoicing. There's a feast. The fatted calf is slain. The best robe is put on. The rings on the finger and shoes on his feet. All of this happened because of when he came to himself. But there's something else that happened because he came to himself. There's another son. Mason, you were right. That was always one of the things that bothered me, was about this other son. You know? But I got to looking at this, and there's some things I can tell you about this elder son. Okay? I can't swear I'm going to be right on everything, but there's some things just plain written in the Scripture that we just need to pay attention to. And this is all because of when he came to himself. He came home, and this happened. The Father was rejoicing. The Father had a feast. The Father put the best robe on him. Where's the elder brother? Where's the elder son? The elder son is in the field. He wasn't at the party. He wasn't at the feast. The elder son was in the field when the Father received his lost son. And the elder son was in the field when the best robe, the ring, the shoes were given to that found son. And the elder son was in the field when the fatted calf was slain and the returned living son was sitting at the table with the Father. That elder son was in the field when the rejoicing was going on. He heard the music and dancing. When he found out about it, the elder son would not go in. The elder son would not go in. The Father came to the elder son. Guess what? He listened to the elder son. Now this is a parable. Okay? And the elder son complained and disapproved and disagreed with the actions of the Father. I don't. I'll tell you that right now. Everything I spoke of earlier, meeting and kissing the Son in grace, meeting him there before he ever got there, in the rags and the filth of the world was still on him, but hugging him and kissing him. The elder son disagreed with that. Clothing him, rejoicing, feasting, eating at the Father's table. The elder son disagreed with that. Showing forth mercy and grace and righteousness. This elder son disagreed with all that. Vehemently. And fervently. I had to use a couple adjectives. Then the elder son started speaking about his works and his lack of transgression. And the father explained. You can read it. The father explained what he did was the right thing to do. And this elder son wouldn't have none of it. He had none of it. Wouldn't have a lick of it. And the father entreated. But I'll tell you this. We never see that elder son come into that feast. He doesn't. Not in this parable. And I believe Christ telling it kind of knew what he was doing. And I'll tell you exactly why. Because that elder son was not in his right mind. He was not. I'm sorry. I mean, you know, maybe you don't want to come to the party. That's okay. But don't disapprove of the work of the Father. Ever. Never disapprove of the work of the Father. Not in a parable Christ is telling. You don't disagree with the Father's work. Because the Father's work is the Father's work. It ain't yours. And I don't care if you're a younger son, an elder son, or no son. It doesn't matter. The Father's work is the Father's work. My word has gone out. And it ain't coming back until it accomplishes exactly what I told it to do. Earl used to... That song, "This Is My Father's World." You know? Mahalia Jackson, he's got the whole world in his hands. He does. And he does exactly with it as he sees fit. And the problem with his elder son is the elder son. That's exactly what this problem is. He was not in his right mind. And what can I tell you about this other son? What's it supposed to mean in this parable? Boy, that's a bone of contention with some people. There's some say this is the church and the Jews. Or it's the Jews and the Gentiles. As far as I can tell, the only people Christ was speaking to here was Jews. They're all Jews. So I don't think that's it. Although there is something to be said there, but that's not the place. Not what it's referring to. All I can direct your attention to is the introduction of this parable. Why was Christ telling this parable? To whom was he telling this parable? Well, verse 1 says, "There drew near unto him all the publicans and sinners." Why? For to hear him. And the Pharisees and scribes murmured, saying, "This man receiveth sinners and eateth with them." Okay? And I can tell you how this is written. It's kind of funny, but where that word murmuring is, okay, they weren't saying that, "This man receiveth sinners and eats with them." I think what they were saying, they said, "This man receives sinners." They were murmuring. My dad hated murmuring. I told you about that. He called it mumbling. If you said something under your breath, he made you say it out loud. I'm going to tell you something. Christ knew exactly what was in their hearts, much less what they were saying. They're saying, "This man receives sinners and eats with them." Unclean publicans, sinners. What were they doing? They were murmuring, they were complaining, and they were disagreeing with the work of the Christ. That's what they were doing. Wow. That sort of sounds like that elder son. They didn't like the way Christ worked. The world doesn't like the way that Christ works. And I'll tell you this, the religious world really hates the way the Christ works and what the Father does. That apprehending, Walter, Religious people hate that apprehended. Now, I said these were all Jews that Christ was speaking to here. These Pharisees, these scribes, the publicans, and the sinners. They're all Jews. This was the difference. Christ was showing with this parable, all three parts. He came unto his own, and his own received him not. John 1:11. He came unto his own, and his own received him not, but as many as received him. As many as came to himself. To them gave he power to become what? The sons of God. Even to them that believe on his name. But he doesn't stop there. Which were born. Not of blood. Not of the will of the flesh. Nor of the will of man. Doesn't matter whether you're a Pharisee or a scribe. Or a publican or a sinner. But of God. The sheep, the coin, and the son already belong to someone. And when that lost son came to himself, it is because he was born of God. Born from above. And he saw, and he entered in. He came to the Father. That's the parable. You do come. Don't forget the finding and the bringing are all the work of the one who owns that son, that coin, and that sheep. But you do come. It's there. That's what? It's all there. He was born of God, born from above. He saw and he entered in. He came to the Father. And he came specifically to his Father. Now, have you come to yourself? Is the question. Have you ever seen your lack, your need, and your desire to come to him? Do you know where to go? Prodigal knew exactly where to go. When he came to himself, he knew exactly where to go. And here's another question. Do you rejoice and join the feast when others come? That was that sign of that elder son. Are you hanging out in the field? Poor Penny. Gonna eat a worm sitting in a garden, whatever it was Earl used to always talk about. I'm gonna sit in the garden and eat worms. You can do that if you want to. I ain't gonna stop you because I'm gonna be eating. That's right. I'm going where the food is, where the fatted calf's been killed. And I will rejoice when I see a brother or sister join. That's what you need to do. That's the question. Our Heavenly Father, we are thankful again for this time and this place. Thank you for all you've done for us. And your finding us and bringing us in. And your giving to us of our right minds. That we would see you and your Son, our Lord. Be with Walter as he comes and preaches the gospel to us. Thank you, Lord, for everything you've done and are doing. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.